with Chuck.
I was delighted that some people enjoyed my analysis of the episode of Unsolved Mysteries regarding Mr. Ray Rivera, so while watching season 2 I made some notes. Here's my position on episode 1 regarding the death of US citizen Mr. John Jack Wheeler, a 66-year-old white male found dead on a Delaware landfill site on the morning of December 31st, 2010. This was presented as a mystery of, you know, what happened to him, and there was thoughts of a conspiracy and government agents and things like that, but I've got my own position on this. So first off, this video assumes you've already watched the episode and reflected on its content. Second, I want to emphasize this is simply my opinion based on the information available as presented in the episode, using deductive logic to try and answer the questions raised. To provide a context of what happened and why. The key to understanding what happened is to realize the full extent of the victim's mental health issues. We know he had bipolar disorder, that's stated explicitly, also that he was on medication, having to regularly visit a pharmacist to receive his prescription. Some quotes used to describe Mr. Wheeler in the video are, "He was marked by bouts of frenetic activity, also impulsive or overly emotional. He had an intensity to life that few of us manifest. He was passionate about everything he did. He put energy into everything he did. Things are never dull with him around. Always doing something. Something was always on his mind. He always had 15 things happening at once." So the people in the video commenting are being very polite. Bipolar affected individuals will have high energy and be manic, full of beans and zest for life and so on. They will also have massive negative emotional crashes, lows as deep as the highs, mania, and quite often negative thoughts and suicidal urges. It's ups and downs, not just ups. So let me break it down for you. It's Christmas 2010. Jack's with his family in New York, and everyone refers to this as a normal Christmas. The simplest explanation for what happens next is that for whatever reason, Jack stopped taking his meds at this point. Now, maybe it's because everyone's having a good time and staying up late and drinking. Maybe there was some family drama. Maybe he's just out of sync with his normal routine, what with being on holiday. But for whatever reason, he stops taking the meds. A couple days go by and we get to Tuesday. Tuesday rolls around. This is December 28th. He gets up. He gets dressed for work, he grabs his briefcase, and he heads to the train station to go to Washington. He's out the door by 7 a.m. So he's up very early, and he's, you know, showered and dressed and out. His wife remarks, "I thought we were going to the movies." So he wasn't supposed to be going to work that day. There'd already been conversations on what will we do on Tuesday, you know, what will we do together as a family. They were going to have family time. They were going to see the pictures. Suddenly, there's a complete change of plans, point blank. He didn't mention it the night before. He wakes up, boom, he's out the door at 7 a.m. Now, his wife is going to consistently miss the point throughout the documentary. She assumes that when he says he needed to go into the office, that this was true. So instead, let's think that he's getting up. He's already in a confused state. He isn't really aware of what's going on. But it's a weekday. It's a Tuesday. So it's a work day for him. So he dresses and he preps for work on a kind of autopilot and leaves the house. He's going to work because it's Tuesday. He's out the door very early, so nobody really has time to talk to him or recognize what's going on. I would posit that there was no work that day. He's just doing a normal day. A routine normal day. So he goes to Washington DC from New York City, leaving the house at 7 a.m. It's a 3.5 hour train journey on average, and he ends the day at his home in Delaware in Newcastle around 5:30 in the afternoon. So when you sort of slot that together, he's only going to spend a couple of hours, maybe five at most, at work in DC to allow for travel time. There's no clear idea what he was doing in Washington that day either. He's supposed to be at work, but there's no colleagues or co-workers interviewed, so apparently nobody had any interactions with him. Also, nothing about him arriving at the MITRE Corp building, which he would need the key fob for, which will be relevant later. So it was something important enough for him to cancel his holiday family plans for, but not important enough for him to warrant a full day's work. He's lost his briefcase on the train, by the way. He arrives at DC, and he literally gets off the train, leaving his briefcase on the overhead rack or under his chair or wherever he put it originally during the journey. He's in a haze. It's likely he doesn't even really go to work, and he just wanders around DC for the afternoon, which would explain why he's, you know, why there's no contact with anyone in the office, and nobody's saying, oh, he was acting a bit weird that day, or country-wise. Oh, he was completely normal in the office and he was just cracking on this project. There's no comment on that. So I think what actually happened is he goes to DC, he's left his briefcase on the train, and this is never found, possibly stolen, possibly just in lost and found, and he's just walking around the city. By 5:30, he returns again, just on instinct, on autopilot, to his second house, the house he has in Newcastle. So then that night, there's this smoke bomb incident at 11:30. His cell phone is left at the scene, so we know he did it. This is at the Battery Park property across from his residence being built. Jack seems very fired up over it, that it was wrong, and he was upset that this house was being built. So the house is a trigger for his condition as well. I think he had some smoke bombs, and he was planning on starting some kind of arson. But when he tried to do the sabotage, it didn't work as expected. Just smoke, no fire, no damage. So he would have activated this thing that I think he was expecting to, you know, like a little miniature bomb or something, but actually it just kicks out a bunch of smoke, and he realizes it's all gone wrong and there's no fire and there's this big cloud of smoke everywhere. So he runs away from the scene, and he drops his phone in the process. Now, when he returns to his house and he can't find his phone, he gets very worked up because of this. Now, it's also possible that he injured his foot in the race back home. But that's more speculative on my part. But I think that's the order of what's happened here. So back at his house across the street, he's now very agitated. It's around midnight. He's not taking his meds still. He can't contact his wife on his phone, and he's looking for his mobile so he can establish some kind of normality. So this brings us to the break-in. The revelation of the break-in is that there is no break-in, of course. This is just Jack walking around his house, crazy, looking for his phone. The neighbor talks a lot about the supposed break-in, that there was a second floor window open, so he left a window open. The door was unlocked, the storm door was closed, but the inner door was ajar. There's Comet bleach powder, kitchen product, scattered on the floor with a bare footprints visible. Plants tipped over, you've got spices and herbs scattered, and some cupboard doors left open, and Jack's West Point ceremonial sword is on the floor, under layers of the powder. So This is for me the footprint is what unraveled everything. The footprint is the equivalent of the Ray Rivera story with the spectacles and the mobile intact on the roof of the hotel. Once you have that data point, you can kind of just go, oh, okay, it's this. So it's the same thing with the footprint. Although I know people are still trying to argue that he was thrown out of a helicopter. I know. I read the comments. So anyway, with this one, the footprint is the thing that unravels everything. So the footprint in the dropped bleach powder is Jack's footprint, because thieves are not going to break into a house in winter barefoot, and they're not going to take their shoes off whilst they're creeping around someone's house. There is no evidence of a break-in. This is all projection. The neighbor lets himself in. Right, there's no broken windows or locks. The inner door was ajar and the outer door was closed, so it's just that there were two doors and he forgot to shut one as he walked out the following day. The comet bleach powder is on the sword, so he's walking around barefoot. He drops the weapon he was holding, rummages in the cupboard, spills the bleach powder on top of the sword. So that's why you have that layering of it in that way. A thief who had gone into the house far enough to find the ceremonial sword could be expected to take the sword, as it's a trophy or to sell. Or he would have encountered Jack and there would have been a confrontation. The sword is clean. There's no signs of a struggle. Only the single person rooting through cupboards and the spice rack. So we've got a picture of a man barefoot, presumably undressed, wielding a sword, wandering around his house, one in the morning or something. And I think what he was doing is he was searching for his phone. I think he's looking for his phone in the kitchen and he's sort of throwing things around. He's having an episode and he's alone and he can't call his wife and he wants to get his phone back so he can reestablish normalcy. And he can't, the poor guy. So eventually he exhausts himself after making a big mess and goes to bed. So that takes us to Wednesday the 29th of December. He wakes up in the aftermath of the night before. There's still no meds in his system. He writes this email to his company and says there was a break in the previous day and he lost key items that he needed to access his business. So he states that he's lost his wallet, his key fob, his briefcase and his cell phone. Now, interestingly, he's saying his phone was stolen. Now, we know it wasn't. It was left at the house across the street. I do not believe for a minute that a thief snuck into a random house in Newcastle, dicked around in a kitchen, tipping plants and herbs over, spilt cheap cleaning products like a cheeky raccoon, and then picks up a phone, waddles up the hill to a construction site, decides to fling the cheap phone on the ground and set off some smoke bombs. No, that didn't happen. This was Jack. It's Jack's phone at the scene of a place he wanted gone, a place he was interested in. So I think maybe he's lying in the email to hide the evidence of what he did at the house across the street. Now that would imply clearer thinking, a bit of strategy. He's thinking, oh God, they're going to find the rubbish arson attempt on my phone and link it to me, so I better report that it's stolen. So, okay, that makes sense. So of course, if your house was actually broken into and you have a sword-wielding thief take your shit, you'd probably ring the police and your wife. He does neither. Pretty sure a nice house like that for boomers would have a landline phone. So, he's sat there with a telephone nearby and he doesn't bother calling law enforcement or his family. This is highly unlikely. The purpose of the email is just to, justify why his phone could potentially turn up somewhere else. So we have the wife. By the way, that also means that he's admitting that he doesn't have his key fob. And the key fob would be to get into his office at work. So what was he doing the previous day? Again, he's just wandering around. We have the wife then saying she tried to call him. And she said, never before had I not been able to reach him. Okay. So did you call the house phone? We don't know. They never ask her. Never gets quoted. Was there any discussion of his work trip? Where he was going? For how long? Doesn't seem like it. Was she bothered by this? For some reason, no. Ladies in the audience, please think how many hours it would take before you got worried that your husband with mental health issues was uncontactable in winter. I find this strand of data really bizarre. This woman seems so blasé about her husband's situation. But it'll get worse. So it seems like Jack sits around his house pretty much all day. I imagine he was up late, what with the arson and manic episode. So he's probably woken up pretty late, to be fair. He goes to his local pharmacy at 6 p.m. A key point here is that this is the pharmacy where he normally gets his medication. I think on some level he knew instinctively to go there. But his thinking is properly scrambled again. The pharmacist is a dick here for not asking the obvious question, oh, hey, Jack, are you here to get your meds? Because that might have saved his life. But instead, nah, we just take everything at face value. He's got the guy walking around the store, limping, asking for a ride to Wilmington. Has he already lost a shoe in the footage? It's hard to tell, but he's sort of limping. Now, why is he going to Wilmington, 6 miles to the north of Newcastle? Because this is where he parked his car prior to leaving for NYC. Okay, so he's trying to get home by car, not just get the train back like you'd expect him to. Again, his thinking is warped. He gets dropped off and goes to a multi-story car park. So he's in Wilmington. In the evening, but this is the wrong car park. His car was parked several blocks away, so he can't remember the car park it was parked in. Now, then we have the stepdaughter tell an interesting story that her stepfather was directionally challenged and got lost frequently. He liked to go for walks at a specific park, Madison Square Park, where he would walk round and round and round the park because the park's a square. and it was something he was actually able to navigate. The wife then adds that not only did he have no sense of direction, but that he would lose things frequently. He was famous for having to take taxi rides home because he had once again forgotten where his car was. This happened regularly. Parking a car and not being able to find it on a regular basis is not normal. There's a lot of cope and bullshit hand-waving about how this guy was, you know, so intelligent and he was so caught up in his to-do list and so busy and so on. It's completely blind to an alternative perspective. The gentleman had mental health issues. His brain was going. He had some kind of dementia, possibly. And he wasn't able to process information clearly anymore. So we now have CCTV showing Jack asking questions at the car park reception area. He's disheveled. He's agitated. He's got one shoe on, one shoe off. Presumably, this agitation is from him walking around the car park, not finding his car, and getting increasingly upset. He's in reception. He's peering around corners. He's paranoid and jumpy. He tells the car park attendant his briefcase has been stolen. Now, we know he didn't have the briefcase when he was at the pharmacy slightly earlier. So again, this tells us that he doesn't understand what's going on. He doesn't know what's going on around him. The last time he had the briefcase was on the train. So this is why I'm saying that the most simplest explanation is that he left his briefcase on the train. The briefcase contained his parking ticket. So again, you have an interesting example of a logical short circuit. If you're trying to recover your car, but you know that the ticket to retrieve your car is inside your briefcase, which you have lost, why are you bothering to visit the pharmacy asking for a lift, let alone to the wrong car park? The attendant asked him repeatedly who stole the briefcase or how this happened, and he can't answer the question. He just repeats himself. He doesn't know himself. So I know it's a lot sexier to start thinking about him being pursued by secret forces, but this is just cope in this case. When I saw the surveillance footage, it didn't look like Jack. She's been so sheltered from him, she doesn't know. She's never seen him on a low point, or she's in denial, one of the two. And then we realise from the wife that although she tries to massively downplay it, he did have manic episodes that she recognised from, in this footage, which is interesting. Also that he needed to be on regular medication to offset his condition. So again, all you need to do is start the dominoes falling, is to remove his dose around Christmas, give it a couple of days for the crazy to kick in, and then it goes from there. So the dude says he might have had a mental breakdown, but also that he might have been attacked, hence the injured foot. Nope, he was limping in the pharmacy. Footage at this point shows he's walking around the car park perimeter. Half an hour after talking to the attendant, he's still walking around the car park's perimeter by himself. You know, he's out of it. He's not being pursued. If there were people chasing him or something, they would have caught him by this point. It's an old man on foot. He's not evading them. He's just wandering. He spends the night in the Nemours building office complex, underground passageway complex in downtown Wilmington. I would explain this as that he's just gone to ground. He's completely lost at this point. He's not thinking logically or coherently. And on a very primitive animal instinct level, he's gone to ground. He's retreating. He's sheltering. He's confused. He's afraid, and so he's going underground. He's going into a burrow, essentially. So this takes us to Thursday. The next day is Thursday, December the 30th. He spends all day in the office complex, wandering around aimlessly. Footage shows that he was still there as of 23 minutes past 6. So he must be starving, hungry by this point. He must be exhausted. He must be dehydrated. This will not have helped his mental state. He breaks cover at about 8:40. That evening. He's wearing a hoodie he's stolen from somewhere. He walks past the Hotel Dupont and he's spotted for the last time on CCTV. Now, the investigator says he approached someone, the rumour is that he approached someone asking about going to Philadelphia unclear why. I would say there doesn't have to be a logical reason. The man is completely lost, disorientated in an endless series of nighttime American cities in winter, kind of hellscape that he's wandering around lost in. The wife then tries to justify why she sat on her ass for 3 days with no means to contact her husband, who has mental health issues and isn't answering his phone. She basically has no rationale for her behaviour. She just basically says she was in denial that anything bad had happened. I got to say, this is such weird behaviour. A wife would, you'd expect your wife to be concerned about her husband's whereabouts. Never mind the pursued by assassins angle for this plot. The real spooky conspiracy of the episode is that the wife allowed her husband to get into trouble by choosing inaction. Deeply weird. So, around about 11 o'clock, witness places Jack in a taxi sharing a ride to Newark. We don't know 100% that this is a true witness sighting, but given that we know he ends up in Newark, there's no reason to doubt it either. He ends up at the University of Delaware in Newark, specifically the College of Arts. I imagine he's just been randomly dropped off near here, presumably without paying, as he had no wallet. It's the middle of the night, he's confused, probably completely delirious, he's an old guy, mental health aside, he's barely slept, he's slept rough in a stairwell when he last did, he's not eaten, he's not had water, he's going to be in a right state. So basically at this point he's going to come across as a crazy homeless person. So now we reach the point of the murder. I would of course like to be an obnoxious prick at this point and say that the man technically died at the hands of local vagrants, but really he died because of the complete systemic failure of everyone in his life to give a shit or act like normal human beings. The autopsy shows that he was 66 years old at the time of death, elderly male, more likely to be suffering dementia. He was wearing a thermal sweatshirt, the hoodie he stole, and his flies are unzipped. Possibly this tells us he was going over to the bins, to the, you know, the back area to take a leak. Possibly they were left unzipped from earlier. Can't prove it either way. The report also clarifies that the ring on his finger was not removable, because he'd never taken it off, and it was properly jammed on there. Now he gained weight over time, and you know you weren't going to be able to rip it off. And his watch was hidden by the sleeve of his cuff-linked shirt. Now this clarifies why it wasn't a mugging, because they didn't take his stuff. They didn't see his watch because it would have been under the sleeve of his shirt, and even if you try to tug at his shirt sleeve, it wouldn't come down because of the cuff-link. And they couldn't get the ring off even if they tried to use force. So the poor guy's got contusions, fractured rib, he's got a collapsed lung, so punches, bruises to the cheeks, mouth, eye sockets, his head's bleeding, sternal neck injury, he's fallen to the ground, and he gets a vicious kicking, and then he's picked up and put into the bin. So the strength of lifting a guy like this would tend to indicate two people at least, and that also tracks with the amount of injuries. So you're probably then saying, all right, well, who would beat him to death? So ignore his background of being involved in government and the military and all this sort of thing. Just as an old guy in ill-kempt clothing in the back area of a city at night in winter, I think he wandered over to this area, maybe to take a leak by the bins, possibly to seek shelter. They tell you that homeless people regularly slept in these kinds of bins overnight. If you're lost in a strange place at night, it's very cold. And again, you're running on a sort of an instinctive animalistic thing of just trying to hide and seek shelter and avoid pursuers. Then you would try and find a place to keep warm. So he's just copying what other people are doing at this point. The problem is this isn't his turf. And the funny thing about humans is that they can get very defensive when they see you, a stranger, in what they see as their area. So mugger, drunk or drug addict, crazy homeless person thinking that Jack was going to steal a bin hotel from him. We're never going to know who specifically killed him. It was very likely to be some kind of lowlife, some kind of like homeless person, junkie, something like that. That's not especially important. What killed him was his mental breakdown. We can kick around a rough profile if you like. Physical beating indicates male, younger, so possibly 20 to 40 years old. Duration of attack indicates strength, stamina, so again, male, younger. Heavy beating, focused on the head and face, is vicious, indicates emotional instability, given that Jack would be a stranger to his attacker, so there was no real time to get beat. beef developed or grudge. The victim was not sexually assaulted or robbed, so it would most likely be an attack from anger. I would suspect a confrontation along the lines of, who are you, what are you doing here, go away, you're not getting my bin, etc. Bearing in mind that Jack would likely have been completely incoherent at this point and not able to string a sentence together. I'd imagine it would have been, you know, sort of a burble back, and then it would have just escalated from there, and he might have been, you know, he might have been aggressive himself and said, no, I'm going this way, get out of my way, that kind of thing. And it went very, very badly. It's unlikely that the victim climbed into the bin. Not that you couldn't climb into that bin, but just given the nature of his beating. So it's far more likely he was thrown in while semi-conscious or unconscious. Lifting someone like that would likely mean more than one assailant, which would fit with the level of injury. So they don't know exactly when he died, but it would have been, you know, sometime in the early hours of the night. So it could be he was wandering around aimlessly, looking for shelter or maybe to go to the bathroom. He goes into a secluded area to do this, away from the main street. He runs into a small group, 2-3 attackers, some kind of altercation, possibly for money. He had no wallet, so, you know, it could have been initially they were going to frisk him for something, got a bit handsy, bit of a scuffle. This escalates to a beating on him opportunistically. Afterwards, after they've beaten him, they put him in the dumpster for a laugh or to hide the body. This does not mean a professional hit. There's no advantage for killing this guy, including here. A hitman would not track him to a back alley in Newark. You would simply just get him at his house in Newcastle when he was returned from work, an elderly man in a house by himself in a quiet neighbourhood where you could just pick the lock, sneak in at 2 a.m. and pop him in the head. That would be the most straightforward way of doing it. Set fire to the house afterwards, cover your tracks, you know, that's all fairly chill way of doing it. Killing him and putting him in a bin in Newark, it's just, yeah, no, he's run into a small group of assholes, basically. So December 31st, it's after midnight now, he dies from the beating in the bin. The body is carried to the landfill by the garbage truck, and by 9:56 a.m. on that Friday morning, his body is found on the landfill. So yeah, that's my take on what happened, putting the timeline in order and looking at what I think is the most likely explanation of events. So yeah, I wonder if anyone watched the episode and was thinking, oh gee, I wonder what happened to him, or maybe you were thinking, oh yeah, I think he was killed for some reason, the MITRE Corporation, they know something. I'm just here to put a bit of clarification in there of what I think actually happened, and I think this is a far more sensible and logical explanation of the events for what was ultimately a very tragic end to what seems to be a very nice guy who didn't deserve the outcome he had. But yeah, it was a spiral from Christmas to New Year, and unfortunately he didn't make it out of that dive.